Always remember a dad who rescues his child. And I hope we can do that with our earthly fathers, but also our heavenly fathers. Now, right now, I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles to a book that I've never asked you to open before. It's Judges 6, 25 through 32. In your student Bibles, which should be posted, I hope they're still on the edges of your pews. If you didn't bring your Bible, grab that one and use it today. Judges chapter 6, verse 25 through 32, page 262 in your student Bible. Now, how do I know that I've never asked you to open to Judges before? Because on my sabbatical, I reviewed all 9.5 years, all 386 sermons that I've given you textually. And I found out, believe it or not, that out of how many books in the Bible are there? 66. Okay, now I need a dad to guess. I need a dad to guess. Guess how many books in 9.5 years, 386 sermons, guess how many books of the Bible I have actually preached from? Any dads? A dad?
56.
56?
65.
65, no. Well, yeah, wow. You guys thought I covered a lot of ground. I didn't. 10? A little better than that. A little better than that. Well, actually, a lot better. Any other guesses? I got a prize for a dad that actually nails it. 34? We're getting close. We're getting further away now. 32?
27.
We're jumping around. 30. Who said 30? Brian. Brian, I'll tell you what, I was at the Goodwill the other day, and that super dad, okay? So good job, you guessed it. Happy Father's Day. So out of the 30, I preached 30 books, and I'm just gonna let you in on a little secret. Deep inside the preacher, there's always the temptation to pick out those verses which you love to preach the most and just re-preach them over and over and over and over again. And while that would be fun and easy for me, eventually it would get dull for you. And moreover, we would miss out on the richness that the full counsel of God's Word can give us. And so, I don't want us to miss out on that. So one of my goals for the next 10 years, if you people will have me here and God allows me to preach it, I want to cover those other 36 books. And we're going to start even today in Judges. And so I've been on vacation. So are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? You're in Judges? I saw someone flash a phone. It's good. We're there. Okay, Judges. I'm going to start by reading verses 25 through 27. And just hang with me. There'll be some context, so just hang with me. Notice people, places, and things. Verse 25. That same night, the Lord said to him, that is Gideon, take the second bull from your father's herd, the one 7 years old. Tear down your father's altar to Baal and cut down the Asherah pole beside it. Then build a proper kind of altar to the Lord your God on top of this height, using the wood from the Asherah pole that you cut down. Offer the second bull as a burnt offering. So Gideon took 10 of his servants and did as the Lord told him. But because he was afraid of his family and the men of the town, he did it at night rather than in the daytime. You're filling the blanks. Gideon's nighttime raid. By the way, they rhyme today. So anybody want to guess? Gideon's nighttime raid made him very afraid. Way to go. You're with me. Okay, let me give you a little bit of context. The Israelites entered the promised land. Moses died. They needed a new leader, so Joshua rose up and took his place. Joshua was a good and godly leader. But when he died, God's people needed new leaders who would defend the soil and the souls of his people. Now, God gave his people the promised land as long as they would keep the promise. What was the promise? We find it in Deuteronomy 5, 4 and 5. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. So guess what they did? They didn't keep the promise. They didn't keep it. So when they lost their souls, they also lost their soil. In other words, as other gods took their love, enemy invaders came in and took their land. And so the battle was on. So God called Gideon. Now, friends, just so you know, we're going to unpack Gideon's story later in the summer when we come back to Judges. But while I was studying for future sermon series, this Father's Day sermon plopped right on my head. And I was like, this is the perfect text for Father's Day. Now, all you need to know is God wanted first to win the souls of his people before he wins the soil. So he tells Gideon his first battle is against the idols in his own town. In fact, his first battle would be with the idols that his own father owned. Think about it. The guy God picks to liberate the soil and the souls of his people is the son of the biggest idolater in town. That's why he's so scared. God is saying, hey, Gideon, tell you what, let's clean up the junk in your family first. Gideon says, okay, mind if I do that at night? God says, okay, and he gets away with it almost. But first, let's apply these verses to us. Can I just ask you a question? Have you recently gotten in trouble for doing something good? I heard a whisper, yes, that's good. Have you recently gotten in trouble for doing something good? Now, if you get busted for being bad, don't expect your heavenly father or your earthly father to bail you out. Mine did. That's pure mercy. He came down the road and picked me up while I was out doing mischief. That's pure mercy, if you get it, and many of us have gotten it. I wish I could get one amen. Then that's great. But what God is doing here with Gideon is something very different and very special. You see, Gideon got in trouble for being good. And God's going to do some miraculous things to help him out. Now, I want to reflect a little, just a little bit more. When was the last time you got in trouble for doing good? If you haven't recently, are you sure you're being a consistent witness in a growingly wicked world? I can remember still quite vividly a movie I walked out on because I knew the movie had gone bad. I knew it had gone bad, but I was with somebody. And at a certain point, the Holy Spirit said, get up and go. And it was offensive to many people involved. Who am I? Well, the Spirit said, get up and go. When the crowd, or even your family, as it was in Gideon's case, goes sinful, will you hear the Spirit of God and act? I want to clarify. He didn't just bust down the idols, the bad idols. He also simultaneously built up the good idols. So often, and we'll come back to this later in the summer, so often God will tell us to bust something down and then build it up at the same time. What has God asked you to bust down and build up? What is he calling you to do? This isn't just for dads. This is the everybody one. But now we're going to zero in and we're going to get in with the dad stuff. Verse 28 through 30. Watch this. Verse 28 through 30. In the morning, when the men of the town got up, there was Baal's altar, demolished, with the Asherah pole beside it, cut down and the second bull sacrificed on the newly built altar. They asked each other, who did this? When they carefully investigated, they were told, Gideon, son of Joash, did it. The men of the town demanded of Joash, bring out your son, he must die, because he has broken down Baal's altar and cut down the Asherah pole beside it. The townsmen saw their idols trashed, and they all wanted Gideon. Ooh, slashed, thrashed. I just had smashed. Creative people here. I love it. Here's where the rubber hits the road. And this is just a quick parental quiz. Quick parental quiz. All the parents in the house. When your kid, that is the person under the age of 18 living in your house, gets in trouble, who's responsible? Oh, I love it that a child said, our parents. Every parent in here was going, oh. Yeah. When they mess up, parents responsible. Ancient times and today, no one knows exactly how old Gideon was. But between Gideon and the mob of the town was one man. Now, we don't know much about Joash up to this point, except that he owned the town idols. So the deck was really stacked. My hunch is the mob probably thought Dad would even lead the charge. After all, he trashed Dad's stuff. Moment of conviction. Any dad here ever seen their stuff get trashed and go, oh! Moment of conviction. Now, you need to know too, they thought he would lead the charge. I don't know how many of you have been part of an angry mob recently. I've been part of an angry mob one time. And let me tell you, folks, it's a scary place to be. Because you know what? If you're in the midst of the mob, and I was in the midst of the mob at the time, and if you don't go along with the violence, you become the recipient of the violence. Joash was in a scary place. He was in a double bind. Because Gideon actually had trashed his stuff. Father Joash might not have known what to do. Idolatry was rampant at that time. A little footnote. Israel's laws said if you build an altar to some other god, you should be killed. But did you notice it got flipped upside down? The Israelites, the town people, are now saying, hey, he trashed the idol altars. We're going to kill him. Things were messed up. I wonder if in the midst of his confusion, I wonder if Joash would have thought, if only it was someone else's stuff. Why did my kid have to trash my stuff? If only it was someone else's kid. Why couldn't some other kid come and trash my stuff? But Joash was stuck. Can I just talk very clearly to my dads for a second? All the dads here. How many of you have been there? Please don't raise your hand. It seems like the world is mad at your kid. And maybe they're even mad at you too. But the bottom line is, you're the only thing between a world of hurt for your child. My friend, if you've been there, you're a father. And regardless of what you did with that situation, I want to bless you just for being there. Because there are an awful lot of kids in this world that have nothing between them and the world that wants to destroy them. So I just say thank you to the dads who were there. But unfortunately, and Dad, you well know, you can't stay there. A choice has to be made. Is Joash going with the mob? Is Joash going to choose his stuff, that is his busted up idols? Is he going to choose his stuff over his son? Now you may say, oh, now, Todd, no one does that anymore. Are you kidding? A dad who would choose his stuff over his son? Nobody does that. Friends, can I just tell you, idols have a sticky grip. And modern-day idolatry is known as addiction. It really is. That stuff that demands our time, our talent, and our treasure more intensely than anything else. It can turn into an addiction. I had the privilege, really, of working with a family through our gas pantry ministry. The Green Ministerial has a gas pantry to help folks get fuel. By the way, it doesn't have any money in it right now because the demand was so high. But at the time it did, I was able to connect with a family. And when we give them fuel, we say, hey, is there anything we can pray about? And this person said, yeah, our three kids were taken away, and we really want to get them back. You see, we chose the meth lab. We chose meth over our kids. And our kids were taken away. People are making choices every day for idols over children. Thankfully, over the course of time, we were able to see those kids come back. Because instead of trashing their kids, they trashed their idol and took the kids back and got the kids back in their hearts and in their home. I'd like you to reflect on the application question that you see. Did your dad ever get caught in the middle of your trouble? This could be good or bad trouble. What happened? What happened when your dad was caught in the middle of your trouble? Did he blow it? Maybe your dad went with the mob. If he did, I just want to say on behalf of the Heavenly Father, I'm sorry. I'm sorry your dad messed up. I wish at the moment of truth he would have chose the right thing, but he didn't. And you're probably still hurting from it, and I'm sorry. But if we can just think for one moment about one dad who maybe did do the right thing. Maybe your dad did what Joash is about to do. Regardless, I would like us to simply see the situation. It really is what defines dads. And eventually every dad will face it. So I would ask you, all of you as children of earthly fathers, pray for your dad. Pray for your dad. Because almost on a daily basis, dads face choices that define them. Pray for that time that comes to your dad and that he will make the right choice, just like Joash. Let's get to Joash's moment of glory. Verse 31 and 32. But Joash. Two of my favorite words in the whole text. But Joash replied to the hostile crowd around him, "Are you going to plead Baal's cause? Are you trying to save him? Whoever fights for him shall be put to death by morning. If Baal is really God, he can defend himself when someone breaks down his altar." So that day, they called Gideon, Jerubbaal, saying, "Let Baal contend with him, because he broke down Baal's altar." Joash put his life on the line to save his son and proves the idols benign. I use that word from the medical sense. It's harmless. It's benign. Baal isn't going to hurt anybody. But here's the news. Something happened here in the heat of the moment. With the hostile crowd swirling around her, this idolater chose God and his son at great risk to himself. I don't know how you read the middle of verse 31 where it says, "Whoever da 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 will be dead by morning." Let me translate that for you. If you come after my son, the one who's serving the real God, if you come after him, either God or I will take care of you. You'll be dead by morning. I believe two people got saved here. I believe Joash's appeal obviously defused the mob that left muttering. And Gideon's life was saved. But I believe Joash was saved too, from his idolatry and the temptation to abandon his son and forfeit his fatherhood. At the moment of truth, God, our Heavenly Father, empowered Joash, the earthly father, to be faithful rescuing both Father and Son. I just want to speak to my fathers here. Oh, brothers, if you are facing situations and temptations that seem a lot like Joash's, maybe it seems like you're in a lose-lose, won't you turn to God today for rescue? Won't you turn to God today for extra empowerment? For wisdom and courage to do what you need to do to be the faithful father He wants you to be? Several years ago, I offered anointing to our fathers. I think the name of the sermon was Free Oil Change for Fathers. But I offered a moment of anointing for fathers who want a symbol of God's blessing and power in their lives. I'd like to do that today again. This is for a dad's only. During our song of response, I'll be up here in front to anoint any dads who want to come forward. So as the praise team comes and gets in place, I'm going to pray. And then, as the response song begins, I'm going to ask fathers to come forward. And praise team, you can come on up. Anointing, it's nothing magical. What it is a symbol. And I believe it's a good symbol. It's a symbol that was done throughout the Bible times. And so if you're a father who would like to be anointed with wisdom and courage this morning, I'll just be touching your forehead with a little bit of anointing oil and blessing you. And I would invite you to stand for this song of response.